And it was just great growing up playing in front of my home fans, my mother, my father. And most athletes don't get the chance to play in front of their home people. And I did it for quite a long time, and that was one of the best feelings ever. And it's just, you can't really describe it. Because you go to the game, your mom's in the game, your dad's at the game, can see you play, your brothers, friends, families. And it was just one of the best times of my life.
Eastbrook Dental provides the most advanced dental treatments available. Pinhole treatment for gum regrowth. Certified Botox therapy for migraines, tension headaches, or TMJ. Get a free consultation or a new patient $99 special that includes cleaning, x-ray, and comprehensive consultation. 0% financing is available. Book your appointment online at eastbrookdental.com or call 248-449-8000.
Your smile, your health, your happiness is our priority.
Genosco Development Company is a real estate development firm specializing in the creation and preservation of quality housing. GDC, through its subsidiaries and joint ventures, engages in the acquisition, development, ownership, and operational oversight of multifamily communities.
GDC aligns itself with a team of experts that believe every property should serve as an economic and social catalyst to the community.
GDC communities are known for their careful planning, attention to detail, and respect for the environment.
Hi, I'm Kurt David, joined by basketball great Terry Duerod. Terry, thanks for being on the show today. I'm
glad to be here.
So Terry, most of your sports career has been in Detroit. Your post-sports career was in Detroit. Can you help us understand what Detroit and this community means to you?
Oh man, you know, I've been born here, raised here, and the city's coming back, and it's just, everybody talk about Detroit.
Yeah, it's exciting to know that your history is here. Let's talk about that history. As a sports, as an athlete back in Highland Park High School, state championship.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
Almost two.
Yes.
Let's talk about that. What was that like to win a state championship?
Oh, man, that's one of the greatest feelings ever. It's like, you know, you always, when you're young, you see it. When you're in the middle school, you see guys on TV that they just always show the games. You say, wow, I hope that might be me one day.
And it was.
And it was. And yeah. It was just one of the greatest feelings ever.
What was the best memory you have of that?
Oh, when we won the championship with all the guys and we really won it for the guys that the year before, two guys that got hurt in a car accident, one got killed. Mm-hmm. And we did it for them guys.
Yeah, almost won it that year,
yeah,
right? That was the year you almost won it again. That was the second year that you won it. So
yeah, we played Terry Tyler and them. Never forget that. When I pinned the shot on the glass, they called goaltender. But that's fun memories.
Yeah, yeah. And then after high school, you realized you had some opportunity. At what point did you realize, boy, basketball is going to be a ticket for me? You know, I have other options and going to college. At what point did you realize that?
I guess when I got like in the 10th grade, the coach kept telling me, hey, you can be good. You just keep practicing and practicing. So I just started practicing every day. I should go out and shoot 500,000 shots a day. Mm. And then I didn't really know I could play like that until we started playing as a unit. Mm-hmm. And he can say, yeah, you're gonna be all right one day. Yeah, got options, and it worked out fine for me.
And your options, we were looking at different places to go, and you decided to stay local here in Detroit. Why? Why University of Detroit Mercy?
Well, my moms and dad put a lot of pressure on me for that.
Oh, really?
But I wanted to stay home, and UAD was coming, was a, like upcoming university, and Vitale, he sold me. And so when I got there, I wanted to stay home because I played in front of everybody. I grew up here and everybody seen me and I just wanted to stay home.
Yeah, you mentioned Vitale, Coach Vitale, obviously a legendary coach, legendary broadcaster at this point, but what was that like to play for a guy of that caliber?
Oh man, you know, one thing about Dick, and it's always true, he always tell you about his life after basketball, and he always preached that to us. Mm-hmm. Every time he have a speech, he would say that at the end.
It's going to end at some point.
Yeah.
How do you think that impacted you? How did it help you?
Oh, man, it really did because, you know, when you're coming up, you see a lot of struggles.
Yeah.
And you see people that you know struggling. Mm-hmm. And you're like, wow, you know, I want to do something with my life. And it worked out good for me.
Yeah.
Basketball was a way for me to get away and excel.
Yeah,
And make me meet a lot of people. And then you want things them people have. You be like, hey, I gotta try to do something.
And it didn't end there. It did not end there. In fact, Coach Vitale ended up going to the Pistons.
Yes, yes.
And then as a result, he noticed you and said, hey, come on over here with us.
I got drafted in third round. And he said, wow, you know, when I watched you play, I thought you just was a jump shooter. But then, you know, as he left, I started really practicing on other phases of my game. Mm-hmm. and it worked out good for me.
Yeah. Drafted by the Pistons, played for the Pistons. Let's talk about the NBA. What was that like to play in the NBA?
Oh, man, you know, that's a dream come true. You know, you a kid, when you watching all the old greats, Walt Frazier, oh, Dr. J. Never forget, I was a kid when I was came out of high school. Never forget, we used to go like, it was like the AAU. Mm-hmm. We go like, go out to New York and all that. We went to New York, and I seen Dr. J for the first time. And
that kind played of, against him?
No, I ain't played against
just
him.
Just watching?
I watched. I was in high school. We was, okay. You know, we, like the high school, we, it's like a traveling team. Mm-hmm. You get the best guys, and y'all go play New York mm-hmm. and this and that. And we went to the arena, and I seen this guy. I lost my mind. I really did. And that just made me really want to excel in basketball.
You wanted to do that as well.
Yeah.
And you did. In fact, you had a lot of great years here in Detroit, but also a great year with a championship in Boston.
Oh, yeah. I mean, that was another great time in my life.
I mean, you played with some legendary players.
Oh, yeah. And that was like, you thought high school was big, but
let's
when you
talk
go to
about
the pros.
What was it like? I mean, Detroit was great, but playing in Boston, winning an NBA championship.
Oh, like I say, you know, you think it's when you win a high school championship, it's mm-hmm. fun. But when you win the pro championship, it's like no other.
What was that like?
Oh, man, it's like a dream come true. You know how you always watch the games on TV? I always watch the NBA championship every year, and I would never think I would be in that situation. You know,
you ever envision you'd be playing with the Hall of Fame type like Larry Bird, Parrish? I mean, you go through the whole list out there.
Yeah, I know, but you know, you're young and all y'all young at the time. You never
just want to play.
Yeah, you just want to
play. And you were
play.
A fan favorite out there. They loved you out there.
Oh, yeah.
Right? What was that like?
My name. Oh, that was a great feeling. As soon as the game, you know, almost at the end, the fans start hollering and screaming my name.
They got
some fans, man, like no other. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. And it continued after that, though. After, you know, you had some journeys afterwards as far as playing in Boston. Ended up back here in Detroit with the Spirits, right? The CBA team at that time.
Yes, yes. And we won the championship with them.
Yeah, so you came back, played in the CBA with the Detroit Spirits at that time.
Yes.
And won a championship. Yes. Was that the same as winning an NBA championship?
No, it's not the same, but, it, you know, it's still a lot of fun. Mm-hmm. A lot of camaraderie, you meet guys, and, you know, it's still a lot of fun, yeah. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And what about after that, though? You were still wanted to play, right? You were looking at how can I still get paid, how can I play?
Yeah.
What did you end up doing?
I went overseas. Me and my friend Earl Kieran went overseas and played in Italy. Mm. It was a great experience, you know, and that was really fun over there.
Yeah.
So then when I came back, I said, man, wow, I got to start planning my life after basketball, you know.
So you realized at that point that it was.
Oh, yeah.
So you mentioned another great name, Earl Cureton, obviously a teammate from U of B, right?
Yes,
and we saw each other along the way.
Oh, yeah.
What was that like to be able to play with him overseas like that together? I mean, it's unusual that, for one, you're playing over there typically by yourself, maybe with another American, but to have an old teammate like that together. What was that like?
Oh, that's one of the greatest feelings ever because, you know, y'all bond together, y'all like brothers. And really, can't nobody speak English with English, really, me and Earl.
Your Italian wasn't too good, huh?
Exactly, but, you know, we had a great time over there.
Yeah?
Yeah.
What were some of the memories as far as basketball in Italy? What were some of the best things?
Oh, wow. The fans, wow, they nutty over there. Yeah. The fans is really into basketball. Yeah. I mean, really into basketball. So, it was like I say, when I was over, it was just great to be in over there and get see a different culture.
Still get paid.
And get paid. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Totally different.
Totally different.
Well, we're going to take a quick break, but when we come back, we're going to talk about Terry's transition from pro basketball.
I'm Farron Scott.
I'm Steve Scott of the Scott Group.
As a military veteran family, we understand veteran home buying programs.
We are one of only 80 military relocation professionals in Michigan.
We provide strategic, low-cost ideas to maximize your home sale value.
Plus, guide you through the process of purchasing a home with easy zero-down veteran home loan program. That's right, zero-down home loan.
Call us today at 833-SCOTT-MI or visit us at scottgroupmi.com.
Get moving with the Scott Group.
Looking to build a new pool or spa? Need to maintain your pool area to optimal condition? Trust the experts at AquaGuard Pool Services. With over 30 years of experience, you can rest assured that you will have the best pool and spa. From design to construction, AquaGuard Pool Services can provide a comprehensive analysis to give you the perfect pool system. Call AquaGuard Pool Service at 248-787-4522. You'll be glad you did.
Eastbrook Dental provides the most advanced dental treatments available. Pinhole treatment for gum regrowth. Certified Botox therapy for migraines, tension headaches, or TMJ. Get a free consultation or a new patient $99 special that includes cleaning, x-ray, and comprehensive consultation. 0% financing is available. Book your appointment online at eastbrookdental.com or call 248-449-8000.
Your smile, your health, your happiness is our priority.
Genosco Development Company is a real estate development firm specializing in the creation and preservation of quality housing. GDC, through its subsidiaries and joint ventures, engages in the acquisition, development, ownership, and operational oversight of multifamily communities.
GDC aligns itself with a team of experts that believes every property should serve as an economic and social catalyst to the community.
GDC communities are known for their careful planning, attention to detail, and respect for the environment.
Hi, I'm Kurt David, joined by our guest, NBA champion Terry Duerod. Terry, pro basketball has been, you know, it was a great journey for you. You had a great time, as you mentioned, over and over again. You had different places you played, Dallas, Boston, back in Detroit here with the CBA team. Also had a jaunt over in Italy, right, with you mentioned about Earl Cureton, you two playing over there. And what a great experience that was. But Dick Vitale, Coach Vitale, had mentioned to you that basketball at some point would be over, right?
Yes.
And that was planted in the back of your mind. At what point did you realize, boy, you know, something's not quite the same? I mean, you went from winning an NBA championship to a CBA championship to playing overseas. Talk about that journey towards sports being over for you.
Well, I knew sports was coming to an end basically when I was playing in the CBA. Because CBA, you do a lot of driving. Everywhere you go, you got to drive. And I was like, this ain't for me no more.
Traveling in a bus or
vans? Yeah,
okay,
vans.
Okay, so you went from traveling with the world champion NBA team, the Boston Celtics.
Yeah, yeah.
And what was the biggest difference, the transportation, or what did you notice?
Well, you know, you got to drive like 15 hours, then you make a cross-country trip to Bangor, Maine, but you play different stops, you know, and that's grueling.
That's hard enough on your body, let alone
grueling.
Playing.
Yeah.
And so really it was the transportation, you know, going from flying first class or whatever to go to games.
And then the pay wasn't as great, you know, so I said, hey, I got to get me a real job.
So you realized.
And I knew it was coming to that point.
Yeah. I mean, did you want to keep playing? Were you looking at other teams and
looking
at ways?
Well, you want to keep playing, but you sometimes you got to say, hey, ball, you got to look in another direction.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, bills got to be paid.
Right.
You can't
right.
chase ball.
Did you have other options to play overseas or to keep playing overseas?
Well, as I got older, you know, I was like, I got to get me a job.
Mm-hmm. Right.
I got to get a career job.
So even though you love basketball, the game of basketball, you kept thinking in the back of your mind, I got a career job.
Exactly.
What was the motivation for that? Why?
Well, like I say, you know, I've seen a lot of guys, and you see guys that play ball. At the end of their career, they have struggles.
Absolutely.
And you see stories, 30 for 30.
Absolutely.
You see all
that
on TV.
Stats.
You see all that kind of stuff.
Yes.
So you say, hey, I can't just be chasing ball.
Mm-hmm.
You know, basketball been good to me. It's time to move on.
Yeah. So you made a decision at that point.
Yeah.
You started thinking about it, saying, boy, in my life here, you know, time has changed. And
exactly.
Like you said, you went from traveling first class to all of a sudden now you're traveling 15 hours in a van or whatever to get somewhere. And you knew it at that point. And
so, definitely.
How difficult was it, though?
Well, you know, I was young back then. It wasn't really hard on your body because you're young, but I knew that wasn't for me. You know, I knew, sports been good to me. Mm-hmm. I had a great career, and I knew it was coming to an end.
Yeah. What was the moment where you made that decision, where you said, Terry Duerod is done playing basketball?
When we drove to Bangor, Maine.
Really?
That East Coast trip.
Okay.
Wow.
From Detroit in a van.
Yeah. So you go like to New York, you know, certain teams, still, that's a grueling.
So really, you literally were making up your mind at that time, I don't want to do this.
I was telling
anymore.
My wife, I don't want to do this no more.
Really?
Yeah,
okay.
Yeah.
And that was helping to decide.
Yeah.
You didn't think you had any other chances to play?
I was like, CBA, if I can make it back to the pros, but the CBA, it was different back then.
Okay.
Like, ball is totally different now,
And so, after that drive, what did you do? I mean, you drive all the way out to Bangor,
you know,
you come back.
I was still playing, but I knew in my mind that that ball was coming to an end.
Yeah.
And I knew it, so. So
what decisions did you make? What steps along the way did you make at that
and
point?
And then when the CBA decided they wanted to relocate out of Detroit, that really made my mind. I said, no, I'm not going out of town to play no basketball no more.
I think it was Oklahoma or someplace wasn't it?
Yeah. Yeah, and that made my mind up too, so. Mm-hmm. And I knew at that point it was, you know, it was over,
So what was the next step?
So I had little odds and ends jobs. Mm-hmm. I tried like.
Like what? What kind of, like handyman type jobs?
No, I worked at the airport. I was a bus driver, a shuttle driver back and forth.
Mm-hmm.
And I looked at this job and said, no, this ain't for me.
Right.
You know. And then I used to play a lot of rec ball, so a lot of my friends was firemen. So they say, hey, dude, you know the fireman high? We only work 8-9 days a month. I said, what? 8-9 days a month? And that really made me change because it reminded me of playing basketball. You ain't working every single day.
Yeah.
So this might be the job for me.
Right. You get used to that schedule as a basketball player, professional
player. And, took the test. Then they sent it in the mail. I passed it. Do the agility. Agility, it wasn't nothing for me because I was a former athlete. And I was study playing ball because the agility test is a monster. I said, can't be too tough. Mm. So when it did the agility, it wasn't nothing. It was a breeze. Then I was a fireman ever since. Yeah.
So before that step, though, you mentioned driving bus, doing some things like that. What was that like to go from an NBA champion to driving bus at the airport?
Oh, it's tough. It's tough.
What made it tough for you?
Because, everybody know you.
Yeah.
And you be like,
you're
wow.
local. You're from here.
Local.
High school championship.
And you'd be like, this is not the job for me. And I knew it wasn't for me.
Were you
embarrassed
or something?
No,
or
I wasn't ever embarrassed because I was about making money.
Right. You knew you had to provide.
I had to provide. But I knew that wasn't the job for me.
You knew you could do better.
You're going to have bumps in life.
Yeah.
In the road. And I figured that was a bump in my life, And then I had another job, bump in my life. And now when I went to the fire department, I said, this could be a career job for me. Then I decided I love it.
So what kept you going through those bumps, Terry? Because those bumps come along in life, as you mentioned. What kept you going through those bumps?
Well, you see the struggles people have. And I said, well, at least I got a job. Mm. I was, I ain't no guy to be like, this job ain't for me. You turn your
head. Your ego wasn't caught up in that.
Nothing like that.
Okay.
And I knew eventually I would find me something that I wanted to do.
Yeah, and you did. We're going to talk about that because you did it for quite a few years, didn't you?
Yes, yes.
You went from driving buses to other odd jobs to you decided to work with the city of Detroit, right?
Yeah.
And had a great career there as a result. And so we're going to talk about that. But one of the questions I have is going from lighting up nets to putting out fires, right?
Yes.
There's a big transition for
that. Oh, yeah. It's definitely a big transition because you're like, wow. Because you got to figure this. You running in, everybody running out. I was young at the time, and all my friends were like, it's a job. So when I started doing it, I started liking it. It was, the days off, and it wasn't bad.
Yeah,
you
really started.
Yeah, yeah.
We're going to talk about that some more, but we need to take another break. When we come back, we're going to talk to Terry Duerod about life as a Detroit City fireman.
Genosco Development Company is a real estate development firm specializing in the creation and preservation of quality housing. GDC, through its subsidiaries and joint ventures, engages in the acquisition, development, ownership, and operational oversight of multifamily communities.
GDC aligns itself with a team of experts that believes every property should serve as an economic and social catalyst to the community.
GDC communities are known for their careful planning, attention to detail, and respect for the environment.
Join me, Diana Lewis, and support Detroit Rescue Mission Ministries, which provides emergency shelter, substance abuse counseling, job training, transitional housing, and eventually to those who qualify, a permanent home so they can lead healthy, independent lives. Among those in need, military veterans, women with young children, and families. Please call the number on your screen or go online to drmm.org and donate now.
Eastbrook Dental provides the most advanced dental treatments available. Pinhole treatment for gum regrowth. Certified Botox therapy for migraines, tension headaches, or TMJ. Get a free consultation or a new patient $99 special that includes cleaning, x-ray, and comprehensive consultation. 0% financing is available. Book your appointment online at eastbrookdental.com or call 248-449-8000.
Your smile, your health, your happiness is our priority.
I'm Farron Scott.
I'm Steve Scott of the Scott Group.
As a military veteran family, we understand veteran home buying programs.
We are one of only 80 military relocation professionals in Michigan.
We provide strategic, low-cost ideas to maximize your home sale value.
Plus, guide you through the process of purchasing a home with easy zero-down veteran home loan program. That's right, zero-down home loan.
Call us today at 833-SCOTT-MI or visit us at scottgroupmi.com.
Get moving with the Scott Group.
I'm Kurt David, joined by our guest, Terry Duerod. Terry, before the break, we talked about life after pro sports. You knew it was coming. You knew what was going to happen. At some point, you said, I just got to get a job, right? And you got a couple jobs, odd jobs that you did for a while. But then you found something that you became very passionate about, something that you really were attracted to. Initially, it sounded like it might have been the schedule, right? You got attracted to the 8 to 9 month schedule. But then it became a lifelong and a career for you. Let's talk about that. What caused Terry Duerod, NBA champion, to decide that he wanted to be a Detroit City fireman?
Well, like I was telling you, Dave, stopped playing basketball with a bunch of my friends. Then they told me about it.
About this life as a fireman.
Fireman. They said it was great and this and that. Because a lot of them had came on younger. Mm-hmm. They was my age, but they had like maybe 8-10 years ahead of me, though, you know. Because they was like younger guys when they came on. So I said, okay, I'm going to give it a go. So I went, and when I gave it a go, I loved it ever since.
What was the hardest part of joining? Was it the, you know, the physical part you mentioned about was nothing? You're already in peak condition as an athlete.
Well, you know, your first year is learning how to really fight fires. Mm. You know, you got to be in the field like 2 years before
I. What does that mean, being in the field? Can you describe that more? What,
well,
what does that mean?
You know, you getting on the rig every day, and when the bell go off, you in the field. That's what we say in the field. That's the term we use. And you know, as soon as the bell go off, you rushing to get the fires. And I was like, hey, this is not that bad, but it's a dangerous job. Don't get me wrong. It ain't all fun. It's dangerous, right. But you gotta know what you're doing. And that's why you have senior men to teach the younger men how to fight fires.
What was the most danger you were in early on?
Oh, I guess we had an apartment building fire over here on Porter Street. That was one of my first really big ones. I might have been a trial man. And that's when we was up there, and it was rolling like incredible. That's my first really big fire. And I was like nervous, you know, because I'm a young kid.
What did you have to do? What was the...
Well, you got to go in there and put the fire out.
So you got the gear on, you're going inside?
Oh, yeah, you got the gear on. Oh, you got the gear on. You got to have the gear on.
Yeah, yeah.
You got the hose charged and everything, and you go in there, and you advance until you see the glow, until you put the fire out.
Really?
So I did that for like 2 years. But then after 2 years, you could put your name on the driver's list. Because guys was telling me, well, dude, you're a little older. You're 31 years old. You need to put your name on the driver's list.
You started a little bit later in life.
Yeah, because all them started in their 20s. Yeah. So they said, no, you feel young now, but when you get older, your body's going to feel it. So I said, okay, I go on the driver's list. Then I start driving every day. Then you move up the ladder. You drive like the squad. You drive the truck. Then you eventually graduate to drive the engine. And what the engine is, they do the pumping. You pull up to the hydrant, and I control all the water pressure.
You're always with the truck at that time.
Yeah, make sure the water is not too high for the guys that's doing initial firefighting in the inside. So you don't want the pressure too high because they can't hold the line. So you got to know your job, you know.
Yeah, and you learned it along the way.
Oh, yeah.
Did you ever envision, you know, from Highland Park High School to the U of D Mercy to the NBA, that you'd be doing this for a living?
Never envisioned that. Yeah. Never, 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 ever. But, you know, like I say, you have bumps in life. And
Well, how do you think sports prepared you for what you did as a career?
Because you got to be in shape to be a fireman. You got to be in shape. You know, they don't have real fat. Guys get fat after they've been on for a while. But when they first come on, they be slim. They really do. Guys gain, like, because you got great cooks. So you'll gain your first year 20 pounds, 30 pounds your first year.
So you're eating well.
Oh, you're going to eat real well.
Better than the NBA, you think, or what?
Well, yeah, you eat a lot, believe me, a whole lot. So you got
you're burning a lot of calories, though, too,
right? But then you have a lot of guys be like great cooks, and they be the regular cooks, and they cook two meals every day. Then they bring in all kind of stuff that you can't even imagine. I didn't never eat donuts until I got on the fire department, you know what I mean? But that's how I go.
There was a lot of things you didn't do until you got to the fire department, right?
Exactly.
So we talked about putting out fires. We talked about, you know, working a truck, eating donuts. What were some of the best memories? Because you're retired now, right?
Yes.
You're retired from the fire department, mostly because of the age limit, right?
Yes.
Let's talk about that. Let's talk about, you know, what were some of the things that you think sports helped you prepare for that, but then also what you did different?
Well, sports prepare you because you train your body, lifting weights, running. And this job is just like that. When the bell go off, you got to run downstairs, put your gear on. You're always moving, you know. Same thing, same principle.
But it's not just physical, though, too, right? I mean, it's mental. You have to understand.
Oh, yeah, you got to understand. But it's just physical, too, now. Firefighting is physical now. I mean, once you put the fire out, overhauling, what that means is once the fire go out, you got to check for hot spots. You know, you got to – they make the rookies pipe pole, you know, because your arms be tired.
Right.
So you make the rookies do that. But, you know, but they once they get their badge, the next rookies do that,
So professional basketball versus Detroit City firefighting, which one would you say is more difficult and why?
Firefighting is real. I mean, firefighters is life and death. I mean, it ain't, you know.
Basketball was just a game.
Yeah. Firefighter, you know, when the bell go off, you never know what you're going to face when you turn that corner. May have a kid in their trap. You got to be ready.
Yeah. And you felt it was much more important job than what you did before.
Oh, wow, man. Because, you know, babies get trapped. Fire, you know, all kind of stuff. Fire ain't no joke, you know.
Right. So it's much more serious as a result.
Oh, yeah.
But you're still
basketball, at the end of the day, You may blow a knee out or something, but still, mm-hmm. you know, you ain't going to get killed.
Speaking of end of the day, you're still playing.
Yeah.
You're still playing.
Exactly.
Amazingly.
Exactly.
Yeah, your body's still held up.
Because most guys that have a career 25 years, they body going to be banged up on the fire department. Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah. Because you got that tank on your back. You got the gear. You know, a lot
so
of
what was harder, basketball on your body or firefighting, you think?
Oh, firefighter. Hey,
is
man,
it really?
Firefighter.
Much more.
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
Because you got to figure, if you got an apartment for building a fire, 10 stories, you got a tank on your bike.
You
running up
it.
10 stories.
Yeah, you
can't
climb
take
it.
The elevator. That's a no-no.
No.
Yeah.
No, that makes sense.
Yeah.
Well, we're going to take a quick break, but when we come back, we're going to ask a final question for Terry Duerod. We'll be right back.
Do you need a proven winner? Do you want to build a better team, create stronger leaders, and face change like a champion? Kurt David works with highly successful individuals, organizations, and businesses that at times face challenges with leadership, change, and developing passion. Go to KurtDavid.com and allow Kurt the opportunity to work with you.
I'm Kurt David. We're back with our guest, Terry Duerod. Terry, you know, scoring points is one of the best things you're known for. You had 43 points in high school, Highland Park High School, playing at UAD, where you eventually end up going to. What's that, you know, what was that like to score that many points, have that much success, and then be back in the city as a fireman? What was that like for you?
Oh, that was one of the greatest games I ever had in my life. I mean, because Berkeley was number one, and we was number six.
Mm.
And everybody feared Berkeley but us. So, and that was one of the best games ever, that's all I can say.
Yeah, just great memories.
Oh, man.
As a result.
It was so many people in it. It was so packed, you couldn't, it was like standing room only.
And everybody said, Duerod, right, the whole time, or Duerod, or whatever it was. And so, well, one of the things we want to talk about here is that this show is about the transition of professional athletes after sports. Mm-hmm. But we want it to be much more than that. We want it to be about transitions in life. What advice, Terry, would you have for anybody, not just an athlete, but for anybody that's going through a transition or a change in their life? What advice would Terry Duerod have?
Well, you're going to have bumps. You're going to run through bumps, just like bump stops. But you got to keep going and keep going and keep going. Then eventually something's going to open up. You can't never give up.
So tenacity, keeping. And how did that apply? What did you do in your life to do that?
Well, basketball made me because, you know, like Dick always taught you, whatever you want to do, be good at it. Hmm. And he always stressed that. And like I say, Dick, he was important in my life because he always stressed it's going to be. You got to do something after basketball.
Mm-hmm.
Got to do something.
And you applied it to basketball.
Mm-hmm.
You also applied it as a fireman.
Yeah.
I mean, you were rated by your sergeant as being one of the most competitive people on the squad.
Oh,
you always
yeah.
wanted to be first to the fire.
Oh,
and,
yeah. Oh, yeah.
And it's still, what about today, now that you're retired from the fire? What fire department, what do you do now that's competitive?
Oh, I go still play basketball. Young guys be, man, you still competitive. I say, hey, the day I don't play, you know I ain't competitive no more.
Yeah.
I'll just sit down and watch.
It's over at that point.
It's over. So I still try to play a little bit, though.
Well, great advice from Terry Duerod. I'm Kurt David, and that wraps up another show. I'd like to thank Renaissance Village of Detroit for hosting us. Please join us again next time as we watch the stories of professional athletes unfold from Glory Days.